So, let's first make a surface, just to warm up. Hmm? So, if you wish to make a torus, and I think everybody knows how to do, you take a piece of paper, and then you glue this side to this side, and this side to this side. Hmm? And then you get a torus. Hmm? And this picture is completely inefficient because I have to go to the outside. Hmm? So I prefer this picture. The gluing I do by this picture. Hmm? Hmm? Advantages. So let's first do this in the plane. And if I do this like this, then this point gets identified to this point because we glue like this. Hmm? And then this point gets identified because we glue like this. And then this back to this. So finally, there is only one vertex. Huh? And at this vertex, there are four lines crossing. Hmm? And on the torus, if you wish to see those four lines, it is just you draw this and you draw this, and that is the point. Hmm? So on the torus, you get two curves, which I could call A and B. And this is exactly what we did to count the genus. Hmm? That was a pair of curves which intersect transversely in exactly one point. So I wish to play this game in higher genus. So what I do, I take a 4G gon. 4G. Huh? Here there are many. Hmm? Perhaps I take a 4G, G is 2, means 8. So we have already 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Hmm? And what I do to make a surface of genus 2, I identify edges. And this is my model. So I do this. I identify that side with this side. And then this side with this side. So I put already one cross. And then I continue. Over next and over next. If you do this, this makes a surface of genus 2. Everybody sees this immediately. You see this? You see this, you can, oh, that's very good. Huh? Huh? Let's first see if it's true. Hmm? Yeah, it's true. Everybody sees that this is the surface of genus 2. I help you. Draw this line here. Then take a foregone, which is open. And now do the same cross. This makes such a thing. A torus with a disc removed. So on this side, we have the same. So we would have another such thing. So genus 2. And now we know how to continue when we have many. We put those crosses. We have a 4G gon. And we put many crosses, all disjoint. That makes surface. One thing which is interesting, if you take a polygon and you identify at random, by arrows you draw inside the polygon. So we have a polygon. Let's say, with many, 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 many sides, and I draw at random arrows. Completely at random. Of course, all the sides are occupied. Then at the end, I will have a surface. And it is not so easy to know what is the genus. If you put, but if you put only crosses, then the genus is the number of crosses you have put. So we have a way of making surfaces of any genus. But now, in this picture, we look what happens with the corners. So this corner gets identified with this corner. Huh? Then I do this, it gets identified with this corner. Then I do this, it gets identified with this corner. This guy will be identified to one of them. Ah, this corner goes there. I made a mistake already. No, this corner goes there. Ah, this corner. So this corner belongs to my picture. Now I am on the other side. So this corner comes down, is this corner. And now I can go like this, is this corner. Then I go like this. Ah, so when we do this identification, the picture is we have one point in the, and at that point, we have many, many lines going away. Many, many. So all those sectors, they come to this point. I do not know exactly where, but they sit around this point. So I wish, if I wish that the whole picture looks like a Hornes flat manifold, that the sum of angles is 2 pi, I must prepare the picture in such a way that the sum of the angles is 2 pi. So in the plane, that was kind of easy. A square, even if the square is slightly shaky, it's not so, the sum of the angles, for each triangle, the angle is pi, sum of the angles is 2 pi, automatic. But here, it is very bad. In the Euclidean plane, this never happens. Because we have too much triangles. When we have a 4-gigon, then we can make 4g minus 2 triangles. And so the total angle is this. If you add all. So in the plane, it is impossible to manage that we get that we get the sum of the angles is 2 pi. It's impossible. So that's the reason why we are interested in hyperbolic geometry. In hyperbolic geometry, let's take the round model. So what I can do is I can take a tiny 4-gigon. But regular. It's so small, nobody can count how many I draw. Huh? So this should be a 4-gigon. And then the sum of the angles here, because it is like Euclidean geometry, when we draw a small thing, the sum of the angles is 4g minus 2 times pi. And now we make this picture bigger. And our points go to near the boundary. So then, it looks like this. And now I think I have an 8-gon. And the sum of the angles, I can make it as small as I wish. So in the intermediate step, I can manage that such an angle is 2 pi divided by how much sectors we have, 4g, divided by 4g. And when I glue this together, when I put my crosses and glue this together, I get a manifold, which is the surface of genus 2 here. It has the local geometry of our foregon, there where we identify. We have one side is geodesic, the other side is geodesic. The local geometry is the flat local geometry of the model. So it is hyperbolic geometry. And because the sum of the angles around the vertex is also 2 pi, even at the vertex, our geometry is like the geometry of the hyperbolic plane. So in short, when I do this, I get a surface with a metric, G metric, M metric is a Riemannian metric. You get the surface, and the curvature is the curvature of hyperbolic plane. We did not really see this, but we come back to this. The curvature is minus one. So we have a surface with a Riemannian metric, and the curvature is constant minus one. So the uniformization theorem, which is one of the end, is the uniformization, which we don't do today. Yeah? So every surface. So when I say surface, it is understood that it should be compact and connected of genus G sub more than two, three or more. Every surface of this genus with a J field called J, admits a metric M, of constant curvature. Equal to minus one, such that, so up to now, we said nothing. I did not relate this metric to the J field. So we only said there exists a surface of that genus with such a metric. And that we did already, we proved already by the identification we did over there. So we have this. I must hit M and the J field. So we need to continue here such that. So here, very strange symbol. You should not put it in your notes. You should only understand that is, if you have a Riemannian metric in the surface, then around each point you can turn. You can turn in the oriented direction. You can turn about this angle. And this you can do at every point. So the relation is that if you do the oriented right turn over 90 degrees corresponding to that metric, that is exactly what the J field does for you. So J field and metric are related that their right turns of 90 degrees are the same. And this theorem is called uniformization theorem. As long history, first proof was by Koebe, there were tentatives of proof, Poincaré had tentatives, then Brouwer had heavy obstructions to the Poincaré proof, and the proofs made very interesting mistakes, and those mistakes were a motivation to develop topology. So those mistakes in the earlier proofs were very useful, because whole generations, and even we learned topology through those mistakes. So I can say every student try to make as many mistakes as possible. It's very, you learn only by mistakes. Eh? So, and this is true for a person, but also for a whole generation, for the whole collectivity. When we never make mistakes, we learn nothing. So that is the aim. But at least by this construction, we know that theorem is true for every genus, at least for one surface. There exists a surface which is not a counterexample to that theorem. It's of course not proof of the theorem, but already have something. It would be a catastrophe if we find one surface which did not fit the theorem. This is, it goes in a good direction. So that is, so last lecture I wrote on the blackboard this symbol. The Rahm cohomology of the surface with coefficients, the real numbers. I will tell more what it is. That's a vector space, and this vector space has the dimension, and so all this together is topology. So this dimension computes for us something we know already. It computes twice the genus of the surface. But to understand this, we must, of course, know this cohomology. So a very general wording for what means cohomology is the following. You have problems. You have, let's say, one type of problems. And the problem is such that you can locally solve it. Cohomology is a bookkeeping tool which tells you the amount of reasons that exist not to have a solution globally. So, for instance, if somebody studies mathematics, then he very easy to do locally. You go to a course, you learn something before midnight, next day exam, pass the exam, get the cross, next. That's solving locally something. Then suddenly you must write a thesis. And you must do this globally. And what you learn here is there is an obstruction. It is not enough if you know to do something locally. So you learn a piece of algebra, a piece of this, a piece of this. It's not enough. So now we know what is cohomology. Eh? So let's make more precise. Our surface was the manifold. And I do not write, spell out exactly manifold, but it was covered by shorts. I like letter alpha for short, but alpha in a set, and this is a finite set. And those U alphas are open set of the surface, and by coordinates, they are mapped to things U alpha, it's the same name, they do not change the, which is a subset, where we do more. So in our case, it is a differential manifold of dimension 2. It is an open subset in R2. So everything which we do on the surface, we can transport it to this open set. And for instance, what we can talk about a one-form. One-forms have this strange notation. One-forms on the surface with real coefficients. What is such a gadget? Omega does the following. Omega is first a map from the surface to something more complicated. Therefore, I don't tell it here. I tell it here. In the short, I say omega alpha, the same omega but seen in this short, is a map from U alpha to this vector space, call it V, to the dual of this vector space. Is a map which attached to every point is such a thing. And of course, now I already regret put the index, so therefore I suppress it. It's clear that we work in this short. So what is this map? Point P goes to omega index P, is an element here, and omega index P is by definition a linear map from V to the reals. That's the one form. And now, locally, the following is true. Every one form, one differential form, omega, everything we do, everything is smooth. Forgot to say this. We never mentioned this. Every one form omega with a condition, with the condition d omega is zero. Every such one form has a primitive. which is a function. On a smaller open set, function on, which is a function f, with df equal to omega. So, in picture, it would be better as my text. For every point, when I say something is locally true, that means for every point, we can find a neighborhood of that point, which is an open set, such that the statement which we made becomes true in that smaller open set. That means locally something is true. And now, one forms, if they satisfy the condition d omega equal to zero, have the property that locally you can find a function, which is called the primitive, with the property df equal to omega. Perhaps we should prove this. So we are, our short is in R2. So we have an open set, and in this open set a point. So if we have some crazy open set and the point. So what I first can do, I can take a smaller open set, which has easy properties, which is star shaped. From P on, from P, you can see the whole open set. Star-shaped, you can find an open star-shaped neighborhood. And so this was my U alpha, which was sometimes called U again here, perhaps. But this smaller one is called U prime, and the local properties should be true in this U prime. So now we have the statement in a star-shaped set in the plane, a one differential form satisfying this condition, has the property that there exists a primitive. And I wish to prove this with what we learned yesterday, computing the d omega by this parallelogram. So the blackboard is now U prime, the whole blackboard. So here we have our point P. Here I have some other point Q. And I wish to construct a function. So first, this goes in steps. First, we say the function is zero at P. That's easy step. Then, next step is we wish to compute the function at Q. But we are in a star shape. There is a preferred path denoted PQ, going from P to Q. It is a preferred parameterized path from this point to this point. So here I can write a definition. I take the integral over this preferred path of the form omega. If you don't remember this, it is integral 0, 1. You take omega at the point. Now I must do something complicated. 1 minus d times P plus t times q. So for t equal to 0, it is p. For t equal to 1, it is q. The speed of this is, the speed, if I derivative of this, is q minus p, that's a vector. So omega applied to this vector makes a number. For every t we have such a number, we do just dt. So now I have a function. Is this enough or is this not enough? Is it finished, the proof, or is the proof not finished? So we have a function, huh? Need to check? D of this function is our omega. We never checked this. So, How we do this? What we do is we study f, q, and we add to q some vector h. So we run away in this direction. And try to find something reasonable. Here it should be linear in h. And here it should be relatively to h, compared to h, it should be small. So somebody has a candidate. We wish to prove this, eh? So better put here omega at the point Q applied to H. So what was the definition of F at the point Q? We should use this path. Eh? We should go F at the point Q plus H. We should use the path P Q plus H. And here we have a broken path. So I do not really check this at the very end. But if we can prove that the integral, the path integral along the broken path is the same as here, then we are done. I claim this first. So we must prove that this integral is the same as this integral. So what we can do is we can study how much mistakes we make when we do this. So what I do is I draw a new triangle because those letters bother me now. So what I do is, so here was P, here was Q and Q plus H. So what I can do is I can subdivide this triangle n times. So I do for n equal to 3. But I do it in all directions. So here we could say run like this. First we do little, we run like this. We run like this and back here. And then when we are here, we go back here and we run like this. And then, yeah, we continue. We make typically the same kind of error in such a thing when we say this integral is the same as this integral. But the definition was, with this parallelogram computation, we divided by the size of this thing squared. So I subdivide n times. So the size of this thing is 1 over n squared. So the error which we make here is of this type. No, not the error. We divide it by this. So the mistake we make is next order. So when we work with data, which we can differentiate 3 times or more, as smooth, we can do as much. The mistake which we make in this is 1 over n to the power 3. And how many mistakes we make? That's the number of squares we have. The number of squares we have is n square. So the total amount of mistakes is of the size 1 over n. And of course, when we do this and walk back, the internal path cancels. So finally, we get that the mistake when we do this and this, when we subdivide more and more, goes away. There's no mistake. And therefore, I can say, I can take a new definition for FQ. Instead of taking the definition, I take the definition where I start my path here. So when I do FQ you this minus this, I prefer to write it like this. Then I must study this. And this I correct a little. I say this is, perhaps I let it as it was also good, it's perhaps better, was fq plus the integral zero, I do from q to q plus h of omega. I write it like this. And then, now we continue. This, when we run along this interval, this is moving. But I can pretend that omega is constant. So I write fq, and I do integral 0, 1. And instead of taking omega at the right point, I take always omega at the point q. I do here pq. Q plus h. But then I make a mistake. I must correct. I should correct by omega minus omega q. And integrate over the same thing. So this is linear in h. And this is small for two reasons. The integration part is short, and omega is supposed to be continuous. So this is small. So the path is small and the integrate is small. It is small as an order, higher as linear. So this term will be relatively to h small. This is linear in h. So we are done. So the whole thing is we have to change the definition. This path integral should be this. And there comes this subdivision and estimating error and counting how much error we make. And the size of each local error, how much? The total error is this, and then limit for n to infinity, we have the good thing. If we had the Stokes theorem already, then this was immediate. But at this moment, we do not have Stokes theorem. What we have, the definition of d omega was an infinitesimal Stokes. The definition of d omega was exactly Stokes at infinitesimal level. And what we here do is we put those infinitesimal informations together to have something global. So we do Stokes in a very special case. Later on, of course, some moment we need to prove the theorem of Stokes. So this is typically a problem which we can locally solve and not globally. Perhaps not globally. That was the proof that differential forms with this condition have locally a primitive. So differential form with this condition is a technical word. They are called closed. And if they have a primitive, then they are called exact. So this condition goes with the term closed. Omega is closed. And this condition goes with omega is exact. So with those terms, I can say a closed differential form is locally exact. And this gadget measures if globally on the whole surface, it is true that a closed differential form, closed differential one form, is exact or not exact. That is the definition. So we must compute this. And to compute the computation of this, the picture of the surface we had helps us. So we must understand, perhaps, what is a function. We are looking to solve an equation of the type df equal to omega. And f is a function. Before doing this, we should perhaps know what is a function. Can somebody give me weaker things which are almost a function. Things which are almost a function. So if we have a function here, then locally we can draw levels. We can say these are points where the function has the same value, and then here the value is more. So if I wish to picture a function on the plane, locally I draw such a thing. Perhaps with a convention that they say it grows in this direction, and then perhaps the convention which we know from geographical map, line is 1 meter more. And then it would be the to drawing of what is a function. So now we already see that I draw locally a function, it is not always globally a function. Let's say our landscape is the region in between. This here, so here is nothing, and here is nothing. We have a street going around a roundabout. And I must wish to define a function. And I learned already how to draw locally a function. So what I do is, I draw this, then I say on this section, on the turnabout, we know what is a function. And perhaps I put this to say, in this way it becomes more. And then, then I take another open set. And on this open set, I draw also locally a function. And then there where the sets overlap, I manage that the levels fit. I do not draw that the levels do this. That two maps on one, it looks like constant and the other varies. And when I work around like this, then I have perfectly given all over a local function. But clearly, global cannot exist. When I go like this, it becomes more. Does not fit here. And that is the way we go to prove this. So we have our surface. So to solve this here, what we do is, we cut the turnabout. We break this open. Now the picture looks like this. And we wish to make a function on this piece. And here, this piece, a locally given function, we can make a global function. And then in next, we study how easy or how non-easy or how impossible it is to make out of this a global function. And we did all the preparation already to do this for the surface, because what we did, our surface was, I draw it for genus 2, our surface was made by gluing a foregon. And this foregon, we do differential, we can manage this, that this surface is exactly the picture which was there in the hyperbolic plane. And here was the center of the hyperbolic plane of our model, and this is perfectly star-shaped. So this polygon we obtain from the surface by cutting. So here we have our curves A and B. I change this picture slightly. I draw an extra line here, and I cut along this. What this does for me, remember to see genus 2, I had to help you, I draw here something. So here I put an extra piece, and here I put an extra piece. And we do the gluing here like we had. Here, like we did. And the extra pieces we glue also. Then I get exactly this. And this is still star-shaped. So, from this surface, I give it the name. This is the surface where we did some cutting. This is the same surface, but after that we cut. There's a map from this surface to the surface which we have. Could say this is a projection. It is a quotient map because it identifies points. Huh? So we have on this polygon equivalence relation, say some points in the boundary are glued to some other points in the boundary. This is like a quotient map for an equivalence relation. And here we have a differential form. So what I can do is I can pull back this differential form. So now I have a one form, which is here. And it was exact here, it stays exact. So here I can find a primitive. So solve the F, it's not a real F, so I put this above. So now we have a function on the polygon. So we try to glue back. So now we are precise. This and this was glued isometrically. And the points which I draw here are the midpoints. So I can draw this identification arrow, which becomes one of those curves. What we can do is we can check if the value of the function here and here agrees. That's a condition. And the number of and if on the midpoints the values agrees, then it agrees all over because the value here is obtained by doing some integration of omega. But omega is the same here. So when we the midpoints, the values on the midpoint of this function agree, then they agree along the whole edge. So how much errors did I draw? This was perhaps not good. This arrow, I can avoid this. What I can do is I can make the picture less beautiful. Of course, when I can contract this to a point. So then this one goes there, and so it's a mess. I don't try to draw. Then we have exactly 2G errors. That means the number of numerical conditions which I must pronounce to make out of this polygon solution a solution on the surface, that number of conditions are 2G. So this tells us that the dimension of this is at most 2G. But perhaps those conditions are not linear independent. So it could be that the dimension is smaller. So now I must find one forms on the surface such that for all others I can glue, except for one I cannot glue. So this is very easy. We on our surface, so I draw a piece of surface. We have our curves A and B. And A was corresponds to one of conditions. Let's say this gives after gluing gives A. So what I do is along the B curve, which hits A in one point, in this ring, I make a one form. And the one form goes as follows. It is D of a function. The function is zero here. The function is one here. And in between, the function goes from zero to one. And this function, which lives along a B, let's call it G index B. I take D of this. The function does not glue because when it is zero here, when we go back and one there, the function does not glue. But D of the function glues because as soon as the function is constant zero, D will be zero. And it is constant one here, D will be zero. So this differential form, and this differential form is badly written. Here I suggest that they have a function. But it is common use. That's exactly what people do when they talk about d theta along the circle. D theta along the circle You suggest that theta is a function on the circle, but it's not. D theta tells you only the variation of the angle. So I do the same here, and then I get one form where all conditions are okay, except the condition measured along curve A is not okay. And so on, I can do this for every curve, so I can prove that the conditions are linear independent. So that means that the dimension of this space is 2g. But perhaps it is good to write the formal definition. The formal definition is you take all one forms on the surface with the extra condition to be closed, and you take the quotient by all the one forms df, where f is a function. It is a one, is a form with zero vector variables. That is the formal definition of the Durham cohomology. And we computed this dimension is exactly 2g for a surface of genus g. So we have a topological way of computing the genus. Perhaps we clean a little. This is a sub-vector space of this. This is an interdimensional vector space. It is space of functions in some sense. This is also an infinite dimensional vector space, but it is a sub-vector space. Omega is... Ah, here. Ah, yeah, I forgot that, but thank you. Zero. I said close, but I forgot to write it. Yeah. So there are the close forms, modulo the exact ones. That's cohomology. There are many which are not exact. But those which are not exact, we even know that locally we do not have chance to solve our problem. So I said cohomology is a bookkeeping device for knowing how many obstructions, how many reasons we have not to find a solution. Of course, we take problems which locally have already solutions. So there's a competition between locally possible and globally perhaps possible. And you wish to know how big is this perhaps. And there are many examples of this kind, but that is the idea of cohomology. We have our surface. And we wish to understand our surface. So now we behave like, say, physicists. Physicists, if they wish to understand something, then they think, I measure that something. Before doing this measuring, you must go to authorities, ask for funding, and then you can measure. So, for instance, they measure the temperature of the Earth today and spend a lot of money. Mathematician is completely different. When they have a space and they don't know, of course, they also wish to measure. What way they write stupidly this. They say this is the set of all continuous functions defined on X with real values. So no need for funding. You have all the functions you want, you have already. Now remains the question, what do you learn about your space X? So in mathematics, the measurements, they are also there. They are completely for free. Therefore, we take all possible ones. So we have here something. And then we still have the question, why, where, for what is this good? Did we learn something about X? Does somebody a theorem in this direction? So make it easy. Let's say space number one we wish to study is the letter X, which is a graph with four edges, five vertices. And the other space is the letter Y. Now we do our construction. This is a metric space. We take continuous functions. Then this becomes a Banach space. This also a Banach space. Question, are they isomorphic as Banach space? Somebody knows the answer? So this is a Banach space. I think this everybody knows. It's also Banach space. Yeah, but the letters X and Y are not homeomorphic. For instance, as physicists, when you remove this point, I have four pieces, and when I remove this point, I have only three pieces. Not homeomorphic. What? Ah, yes. So, then, here I can say same question, but as Banach ring. So here, what can we do with the functions? When we have two functions, we can add them. And when we have one function and a number, we can lambda times this function. That is what you can do in a vector space. And then in the Banach space, some sequences converge and some don't converge. That's what you can do here. Here, we can do more. When we have functions, we have two functions, we can do two things. We can take the addition and take the product. And then the scalar the same. If we say isomorphic as ring, that means the map should send products to products and so on, and sums to sums. It should be ring isomorphism. So what are the answers? You said that, here it is yes, here it is no. I was looking to you and writing here. So here it is, now I must look again. Here it is yes, and here it is no. Yeah. What does this mean? I'm sure about that. What does this mean? Yeah. So you know the proof. But did you think about this? If you did not think, then you've neglected a big source of knowledge. If you only use knowledge from what you read in textbooks or somebody told you, that is a small part of what you think is also important. So I can tell you what I can prove about this. Let X and Y be finite graphs. So this is a finite graph, this is a finite graph. With at least one edge. So I do not want that to consider the point as graph. Be finite connected graphs. Assume that the Euler characteristic of X equals the Euler characteristic of Y. Then Banach C0 X C0 Y or topologically, not isometrically, topologically, topo this I can prove. What I cannot prove is the question. If chi of X equal, if C0 of X isomorphic as Banach space, isomorphic to this, then chi of X equals chi of Y. So, does the Banach space see the Euler characteristic of the graph? That's the question. I know if the Euler characteristics are the same, then the Banach spaces are the same, or as topologically vector spaces isomorphic. But this I do not. There is a theorem, a general theorem. So, general theorem says the following. Let X be a compact metric space. Then, out of the Banach ring, C0 X, even with the reals, out of this Banach ring, one can restore the topological space X. This is famous theorem of Gelfand. Gelfand. So the ring of continuous functions on a compact metrical space, inside this ring there is enough information to rebuild the topological space. Not the metric, the topological space. But for graphs, perhaps more is true. That the Banach space, I do not know. So we go back to our surface. So a proof of all this is in the notes. So this way, do not spell this out here. So we go back to our surfaces. So we have our surface, but we have a surface with more than only topology. Not metric, we can measure angles. So we have this turning 90 degrees thing. So we study this thing. S is the surface, J is a J field. So want to use functions. Adapted to G. And at the very end, we want to say those functions, they are perhaps a ring. I do not say yet which kind of functions at all, but out of this ring, we want to say something about the surface. We want to restore the surface up to isomorphism of those things. So first try is holomorphic functions. It's J holomorphic functions. We'll say what that is. That is a function defined on the surface and with values in the complex numbers. So function of this type, which are locally with some property. So I do F, I do not spell out with all the notations. We restrict in a short, and I say F restricted in a short. Becomes a function from U to, here I do not need charts. Oh no, excuse me. And this locally was also. Holomorphic functions. I must say what that is. These are functions. These are smooth functions. Later we do perhaps less than smooth, but or smooth functions. So we have a differential. And when we take a tangent vector u, what we can do is we can turn this tangent vector by j. So the correct notation is at the point p, we have j at the point p, and we have a tangent vector u at that point. So what we also can do, we can take the differential at the same point, plug in the tangent vector, then we get a complex number, and this we can multiply by I, which is also turned by 90 degrees. Holomorphic means it's the same. So J holomorphic means that. If S was already a manifold with shorts in C, then locally, this F would be a map from an open set in C to C. Then the turning operation on the left would be multiplied by I. So then here you would find an I. That's holomorphic. That is try. Can somebody tell me why this does not work? So we take the ring of holomorphic functions on the surface S. Is surface. So if the ring is not complicated enough, then we have a long history, and at the end, somebody asks the age of the captain. So the ring should be complicated. But what happened? What is this ring? What means trivial? Ah, yeah. So this ring is not trivial, because the complex numbers is not trivial, but it does really not depend on the surface. There is no way. That is one of main difficulties to study Riemann surface. You do not have enough adapted functions. So, when we do not have functions, we can try something else. That was at every point, the space of linear maps from the tangent space at that point to C. But we can take another space which is adapted to the structure. The traditional notation is 1, 0. So what should I say once more what this is? These are just one forms. But I put a C here. That means it are linear maps from the tangent space to the complex numbers. So perhaps we should study this a little. The tangent space at the point P of S as vector space, this is the same. This is isomorphic to R2. But we have, at this point P, we have also this turning operator. So at the point P, we have a vector space which is isomorphic to R2 with turning operator. So we have R2 together with a new gadget. And this, we can declare that this makes out of this real vector space a complex vector space. So we take U out of R2. I take a lambda, which is A plus BI out of C, and I wish to tell you what it means, lambda multiplied by U. If I have nothing, I cannot do this, because in a real vector space, you cannot multiply by I. But here, we go straight forward. This is A times U. Ah, that's okay. A was a real number. A times U is okay. Then, this I, we take JP applied to U. So we turned U already. And multiply the rest by B. So by this, the vector space, the real vector space, becomes a complex vector space. And those omega 0, 1, what are this? These are linear maps from the tangent space P of S to C. Linear maps with some condition such that L of J U equals I L U. I can also say that the L in question here, so when this gadget was a real vector space, but when I add as information this turning operator, then this gadget is a complex vector space, is a C vector space. And then we have a map. And this 1, 0 means that we ask that this map is a linear in the complex sense that this map is C linear. That's exactly the same as asking this. That is omega 1, 0. At this moment, perhaps, later we need also omega 0, 1, the J, S, C. It's the same story, set of L's, but they are anti-C linear. Anti-C linear means L of J U is minus I L of U. So I think nowadays physicists, they did not manage. I think some claim that they managed to make a difference between future and past. Huh? But to make a difference between I and minus I, I think no physical experiments. Perhaps I'm wrong. Huh? So therefore, if we only concentrate on those guys, we make a choice. Then somebody can ask, why not those? So therefore, we do both. Also, not for today, but it's like at the other end, something which at the end of next week, I hope that we can do this, is one of the main theorems of Riemann. And I can formulate already that theorem. So what we do is we take this space 1, 0, S, J. We take all forms inside this which satisfy an extra condition, which are closed. So this is a one form. And yesterday we learned what is D. So closed means this. This are not all forms. Those are called one forms of type 1-0. So among them, we take those which are closed. That's a vector space. We can compute the dimension of this vector space. And the theorem of Riemann says, this is the genus of the surface. So we do not have functions, but we have many one forms. And out of this, working, we can restore the Riemann surface. So this is something which you cannot do today. But I do not know how much time is. It's over. Yeah, thank you very much.